All right, Michael, what's the answer?
All right, well, let me start off with what I think the answer isn't. So the last one, boosting tends to overfit if boosting trains too long. You just told me a story about that not being true. So I'm going to eliminate that one from consideration. Boosting training
nice
too
to know
long.
You're listening.
Boosting training too long seems like not a good reason for it to overfit.
You're correct.
All right. Boosting tends to overfit if it's a nonlinear problem. So that doesn't seem right. I mean, I guess – no, this one just doesn't seem right at all. Like, I don't see why the problem being linear or nonlinear has anything to do with overfitting.
Okay.
A whole lot of data is the opposite of what tends to cause overfitting. If there's lots of data, then you'd think that it would actually do a pretty reasonable job of you know, there's a lot to fit. There's a lot going on there. It's unlikely to overfit.
Right. And in fact, if a whole lot of data included all of the data and you actually could get zero training error over it, then you know you have zero training, zero generalization error.
Ah, because it'll work on the testing data as well because it's in there.
Right.
All right. Weak learner uses artificial neural network with many layers and nodes. So I'm guessing that you wanted me to think about that being something that on its own is prone to overfitting because it's got a lot of parameters.
Sure.
So if now we're doing boosting over that. So we fit a neural net and then we fit another neural net and we fit another neural net and we're combining all the outputs together in the correct weighted way. It's not obvious to me that that should be a good thing to do. I'm not sure it would overfit, but it seems like it sure could.
Okay. So you're so for now let's put a little question mark to it. Do you think that might be the right answer? Do you want to think about it?
Yeah,
some more?
Let me look at the first one. Weak learner chooses the weakest output. Well, I mean, boosting is supposed to work as long as we have a weak learner. And it doesn't matter if it chooses the weakest or the strongest. All that matters is it does significantly better than a half. So, like, I feel like the only one of these choices that is likely to be true is the second one.
And that is, in fact, correct. So let me give you an example of when that would be correct. So let's imagine I have a big, powerful neural network that can represent any arbitrary function. Okay? Got lots of layers and lots of nodes. So boosting calls it, and it perfectly fits the training data, but of course overfits. So then it returns, and it's got no error, which means all of the examples will have equal weight. And when you go through the loop again, you will just call the same learner, which will use the same neural network, and will return the same neural network. So every time you call the learner, you'll get zero training error, but you'll just get the same neural network over and over and over again, and a weighted sum of the same function is just that function. So if it overfit, boosting will overfit.
Interesting. And not only will it overfit, but it'll kind of be stuck in a horrible loop of error.
Right. So that's why this is the sort of situation where you can imagine boosting will overfit. If the underlying learners all overfit and you can never get them to stop overfitting, then there's really not much you can do.
Interesting.
Now, I do want to have a little semantic argument with you for a moment, Michael. You used the word strongest at some point when you were talking about choosing the weakest output, and I just want to point out that that doesn't really mean anything.
What do you mean it doesn't mean anything?
Well, so what's a strong – what would you call a strong learner?
One that is far away from it. If a weak learner just has to do a little bit better than a half, seems like a strong learner would be something that would be really close to being accurate.
Right. Of course, on the other hand – if by that definition, all strong learners are also weak learners, because anything that does better than a half is still doing better than a half, which is all it requires to be a weak learner.
Yeah, but that's kind of true of people, too. Like a strong person is also a weak person.
No.
Well, it depends how you define it. So if you say that a weak person is someone who can lift at least their own arms, then strong people are also weak people in that they can lift their own arms.
Yes, if you define it that way, and if I define blue to be purple, then I can say blue is purple. But that's not how people define weak people. They define weak people by saying they can't lift more than, not that they can lift at least as much.
I see. So it's this piece of terminology that boosting uses that is in error, not me.
That's one interpretation. It's not the one that I would use, but it's one interpretation. When you say something like a strong learner, I mean, it makes sense to use that kind of term and sort of throw it around and say, well, by a strong learner, I mean someone who's or a learner that's going to overfit or is going to always do really well on the training data. But in kind of a technical definition, it's very difficult to sort of pin down. So don't get too caught up in what a strong learner means if you want to write a proof.
Good point. And also...
seems fair?
Yeah. Also, that this whole notion that strong is sometimes defined as not weak. And it is not the case that if you have something that's not a weak learner, then it's a strong learner. In fact, it's no learner at all.
Exactly. So weak learner is just defined in a way that basically says it gives me at least some information. Good. Let me just throw one more thing in here, and then we can stop talking about this. There are a couple of other cases where boosting tends to overfit. The one that matters the most, or comes up the most, is in the case of pink noise.
Did you say peak noise?
I said pink noise. I even wrote it in red, which looks like pink. It's a strong pink as opposed to a weak pink. I'm sorry, there's no way for that to be obvious from what we've talked about. But as a practical matter, pink noise tends to cause boosting to overfit.
Okay, but this is not a term I'm familiar with unless you're critiquing the musical stylings of a particular performer.
No, although I did recently see them in concert. But that's a whole other conversation. Okay, so pink noise just means uniform noise.
I thought white noise was uniform noise.
No, white noise is Gaussian noise.
Oh.
Okay, so pink noise is uniform noise, and white noise is Gaussian noise. This is why, Michael, by the way, if you ever try to set up a studio or a cool stereo system in your house, you want a pink noise generator so that it covers all the frequencies equally, not just a white noise generator.
Mm.
But boosting tends to overfit in those sorts of circumstances. And you can read more about it in the notes if you want to. But the one that I really want people to get is that if you have an underlying weak learner that overfits, then it is difficult for boosting to overcome that because fundamentally you've already done all your overfitting and there's really not much for boosting to do. Okay, got it?
Got it.
Excellent. It all ties back into margins and it's all one big story, which I think is the lesson of all of machine learning.